So what is the first thing? All right, we're praying, we're preparing, we're going, and we're talking. So what is one of the first things I've got to talk about? Nobody, this is what we have to understand. Nobody can be saved unless they understand what sin is. So that is our whole lesson for today, is sin. Okay? This is one of the biggest things that is missing in salvation today. Most people do not want to address sin. People want to say that, you know what, I'm an okay person. Well, then they don't need saved. Why do you need saved? If I can get to heaven on my own, then why do I need Jesus? So sin is very important. And what you've got to understand, there has to be a relationship when you're soul winning. Right? There is what I called cold turkey soul winning. And by that, I think it's good because it gives us boldness. That means maybe going up to doors, taking a neighborhood, and you're knocking on doors. But a lot of soul winning is personal. You know this person. Okay? So we have to then be led by the Holy Spirit. It's very important to have that relationship with the Holy Spirit. And the reason is because the Holy Spirit will then move us. Because what are we going to be talking to him about? One of the first things that we're going to have to address is sin. That's not an easy subject. Because I don't like to think about my sin. I don't like thinking about my sin because in my flesh, I'm a good guy. I'm a great guy. I do everything right. But when I come to the Bible and the Bible says, hey, all have sinned and come short. The wages of sin is death. Oh, man, those verses kind of hit me hard. So that's what we're gonna talk about. So in lesson two, we're talking about guiding people to the knowledge of their sin. So what is the first thing? Before we can talk about salvation, what does the word saved mean? That's our first question under there. What does the word saved mean? It means to be, or if you're going to save somebody, it means rescued. It means rescued or to deliver them. Okay? So if someone gets saved, they're being rescued. So then that leads us to the next question. So what are we rescuing them from? Yeah, from sin, from eternal punishment. All right, we're being rescued from eternal punishment, from sin. So we need to be saved. We need to be rescued from that. Okay, so let's look at question number three. Pretending that we do not have sin will do what? Pretending that we do not have sin will not solve our problem. All right, pretending that we do not have sin will not solve our problem. So then we have to go to number four. So what does God say about sin? And that's the little box underneath there. So let's think of a couple of verses about sin. Romans 3:10. That's verses showing the fact of sin. Romans 3:10 says what? For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. All right, Romans 3:10. For all have sinned. So what's a couple of key words? All. All right, right there. All right, so who's included?
Everyone.
Oh, wait, are you sure?
Yeah.
I mean, that's pretty clear, isn't it? All have sinned. And that's why we talked about this last week. That's why as we're learning about salvation, this happened yesterday. This is a really neat story as far as salvation. There's a young man. He's been coming to church. He's a teenager, older teenager, I think 16 now. He's been coming to church probably for off and on for about 6 or 7 years. And you know, the Fairhaven Times, that thing that we put out every other week, okay, that little paper, okay. Well, the folks that kind of organized that for us, this teenager they were going to introduce them. We try to introduce a teenager every so often in that Fairhaven Times. My wife was talking to these folks that were going to go out and talk to this teenage boy. He's been coming, like I said, off and on for 5 or 6 years. Really good kid. But as far as I knew, as far as my wife knew, he's never accepted Jesus Christ. Well, in the interview, they say, how did you accept Jesus Christ? Well, we talked to them and we said, hey, when that comes up, I don't know that this boy has ever accepted Jesus Christ as his Savior. So as they were coming up to it, they then shared their testimony, how they got saved. Remember, we talked about that last week. One important thing that you can do and talk to others about salvation is share with them your testimony. If you don't have a testimony of salvation, then it's hard to share it. Okay? So here, they were talking to this boy, and it was actually Dr. Mitchell, and Dr. Mitchell said, hey, why don't we step out on the porch and we'll sit and talk together? So they got to that place and they said, now, why don't you share with me about salvation? This is how I got saved. Dr. Mitchell shares about how he got saved. And the teenage boy looked at him and said, I've never done that. I don't think I've ever gotten saved. So yesterday on his porch, he got saved. Why, he's been coming for a long time. But sharing your salvation testimony and having to talk to others about your testimony kind of makes sure that you know you're saved. Because it's kind of hard for me to share about Christ. Let me share with you about how I know I'm not saved. That's not, you know, if I've never been saved, that's exactly what I'd have to say. You know what? Let me tell you about how to get saved. I've never done it. I have no idea who this Christ is. No, I need to know Christ. And then that's why a relationship a lot of times is how we lead folks to Christ. I'm not saying that we don't meet somebody sometime, and giving out tracts is very important, and God leading us sometime to somebody that we're kind of an acquaintance with, but we're not a close friend. That can happen. But when I'm sharing Christ with somebody, I can then tell them how God convicted me of my sin, because that word all includes me. So I'm not coming to this person like I'm so much better. Because what does it say? All have sinned. The difference is that if they're unsaved, I'm saved. I know I came to a realization that I was a sinner, that I'd done wrong. I can't get to heaven. This person doesn't understand that. So that's why we're leading them through this process of understanding that sin is something that all of us do. All have sinned. And then the next thing, that next verse, the verse is showing the fact of sin as Romans 3:23. That's the wages of sin is death. Most of you guys have a job in here. Okay? What is your wage? Okay? When I was in high school, when I was in college, I worked for minimum wage. Okay, I can remember, this is many years ago, I got minimum wage down at Little Caesars. I worked at Little Caesars paying my bill through college. Okay, and minimum wage was $3.25 an hour. All right, $3.25 an hour. And I can remember in high school getting $3.10. And then I can remember in high school, I think also was $2.75 or $2.85. Okay? So, but that was a wage. So what it was is you work this hour, you get $2.75. So what is a wage? A wage is a payment for what you do. Right? That's a wage. So the wages, the payment of sin, what is it?
Death.
And that death, it's not just talking about dying. The Bible explains to us that it's a second death. And the second death means that we don't just go down into the ground. We die and we either go to heaven or we go to hell. Okay? We believe that there is eternal life, and eternal life is either in heaven or in hell. All right? Eternal life means forever and ever. And so when we say eternal life, I'm going to have eternal life, and an unsaved person is going to have an eternal life. But their eternal life is in hell. My eternal life, I would like it to be in heaven. I would like to do that. And most people would say, well, I would like to be in heaven. But just liking it doesn't mean that they're going to get to heaven. Why? Because heaven, God will, in heaven, God will not allow sin. Sin is not allowed. So there's a wage. Okay? Another verse that shows sin is Isaiah 53. Okay, Isaiah 53. All we like sheep have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his own way, and the Lord hath laid on him the iniquity of us all. Okay, and so there's some other verses. My recommendation to you is during the week, that's why we put them there in that box. Look up those verses. Look up those verses. Analyze them. There's verses there for those who are not going to admit being a sinner even. That's why there's verses there. Even, let me read one of them in Galatians. Galatians chapter 5. All right, Galatians 5, 19. Now the works are the flesh are manifest, which are these, and it gives us a whole list of works of the flesh. All right, and it gives idolatry, witchcraft, hatred, variance, envyings, murders, drunkenness, of the which I tell you before, as I have also told you in time past, that they which do such things shall not inherit the kingdom of God. It gives you a whole list of the works of the flesh, uncleanness, adultery, fornication. And what it's doing there is listing out for those people to say, well, I'm not a sinner. There's a whole list of them. You could even go, for those that don't believe that they're a sinner, you can go to the Ten Commandments. Anybody know where the Ten Commandments are located? Exodus. All right. So another one you could write down there is Exodus 20. Exodus 20. And the list of the Ten Commandments helps us. That's one of the things. It's a guideline there. When I read the Ten Commandments, you know what I find out? I break them. I find out I'm a sinner. All right, the Bible, even getting saved, doesn't make you, it doesn't make you not sin on this earth. Okay, there are some places that they take the Bible, some of the verses in the Bible, and I think they twist them. But what they say is you can have sinless perfection, that on this earth, you can get to a place that you never sin again. Well, you and I, there's a lot of you. You've lived on this earth a long time, and I know some good people. But you know what I do also know about them? They're sinners, okay? There's nobody perfect, okay? We are striving to be better, all right? That's what happens when I get saved. I want to be more like Christ. Christ puts that desire in me, so I'm working at it. But I will not be perfect until I get to heaven, okay? And the reason that there are, that's going to occur is what happened way back in Genesis, the fall of man. And man is sinful. Man is sinful, okay? So in our lesson here, we are guiding people to the knowledge of their sin. So let's go to the next page there. So what is a biblical explanation of sin? A biblical explanation of sin. Let me give you a couple of things here. So the first thing is personal fellowship between the Lord and Adam was broken by sin. So we're going back to Genesis. So look at, watch it. Come on now. All right, so let's go to Genesis chapter 3. All right, see that verse there? Genesis chapter 3, you can write it down. Actually, underneath, if you turn in your Bibles to Genesis, that's in the very beginning of your Bible, okay? If you have a New Testament, you're not gonna find it. But at the very beginning, personal fellowship between the Lord God and Adam was broken by sin. Okay, so the first point there, number one. The fall resulted from an act of willful disobedience. by Adam. How do we know it was a willful disobedience? All right, because in Genesis chapter 2, he was told, Adam was told in Genesis chapter 2, of every tree of the garden thou mayest freely eat, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil thou shalt not eat of it. In the next chapter, what happened? Adam partook of it. All right, if you were told not to do something and you do it, you can have all kinds of excuses, but what is it? It's willful disobedience. So the ruination of man here, man, all right? But Adam had a choice. You know that. Adam had a choice. Okay? The fall resulted from an act of willful disobedience by Adam. Okay? Number two, the fall of man brought immediate change to Adam and Eve. All right, and we have one, two, three, four, five. There's five things that immediately happen, and this is what sin does to all of us. All right, this helps us in studying here in Genesis. It helps us understand this is what sin does. All right, it says here, first of all, sin brings shame. They immediately had a guilty conscience. You know that, those of you that have children. All right, those of you who have children, I did not have to teach my children to sin. All right, I have to teach them to do good, okay? You don't have to teach them to do bad. All right, those of you that have children, you know that. Because I never had to tell them to sneak. They just knew it. Why? Because that is that fallen nature that was, they were born with that. But I know this with my kids. I could come in and look at them, and they'd been doing something wrong, and I could see the shame there. When they're young, they have that innocence, and there's shame there. Now, some people in today's day and age, they're all upset because they're like, you know what? How come these people aren't accepted? How come they're not accepted? I mean, they're all right, immoral people. You know, we have to accept them. How come they feel guilty? You know why they feel guilty? Because sin makes you feel guilty. That does. It brings shame. And in a society that is kind of built on morals, that is a good thing to have shame. It's a good thing to have guilt. Because what if you live in a society that has no guilt or shame? You're gonna have a bad society, that's what I can tell you. Okay? So shame is a part. Sin. Sin awakened their conscience. Their innocency was gone. So shame. Secondly, in Genesis 3:8, it says this, "In the day that thou eatest thereof, thou shalt surely die." So the second thing that happens with sin is separation. Right? Sin separates us from God. Sin separates us. God will not have sin in his presence. What's a great example of that? When Jesus died on the cross, what did even God the Father do to his son? He turned. All right, he turned his back on him. All right, here's his own son. We can read that. That's in the New Testament. He turned his back. God the Father said, man, I can't picture that. I can't look at this. Turned his back on him. Because why? Sin separates us from God. We have to understand that. There is a separation from God. Spiritually, when Adam and Eve sinned that day, they spiritually died. That was a spiritual death. All right, so then the third thing. So the fall, what is the fall bringing? It brings shame. It brings separation. It also brings, and Adam teaches us this, it brings a self-righteousness. It brings a self-righteousness. Where do we see this in the story of Adam and Eve? Adam and Eve all of a sudden understood, and we're not trying to be crude or rude here. All right, but Adam and Eve were married. Okay, the Bible talks about marriage, and we don't have time to get into it. But here, Adam and Eve They were unclothed there together, but it was just, it's a husband and wife. They're fine together. All right. But then all of a sudden there's shame, and Adam and Eve by themselves, what did they try to do? They tried to cover themselves. All right. They tried to cover themselves. That was their attempt. Their attempt to make themselves better. And this is what we find in society, in the world. That's religions. Religions, what have religions tried to do? I want you to feel good. So we come up with our own attempts to make ourselves good. So that's the idea of good works. Well, if I do enough, if I do enough for the poor, if I do enough for this, if I join this organization, then man, I can get to heaven. Now, after I'm saved and God saves me, guess what? The Bible tells us to, in Hebrews chapter 10, it tells us, or 12, it tells us to provoke one another to good works. Okay? It's very important that we do good works. All right? That's better than doing bad works. Okay? But those good works don't get me to heaven. But when I am unsaved, I'm trying to get myself to heaven, and that's not going to work. And that has always been the case. Right here at the beginning of time, what is Adam trying to do and Eve? They're trying to fix the problem themselves instead of letting God fix it. So the fall brought immediate change. Shame, separation, self-righteous attempts to cover their sin. Number four, selfishness. All right, when Adam and Eve, selfishness, and what do we see with Adam and Eve? To me, it was pretty selfish of Eve, and it was pretty selfish of Adam, because when God came to Adam, that's pretty selfish to say, hey, the woman, you know what? You made her. And then Eve says, the snake, the serpent. Okay, so what is it? It is our selfish inclination to deny that I'm a sinner. All right, that's my selfish inclination. My selfish inclination is like, no, wait, don't blame me. It's their fault. All right, that's self-centeredness, isn't it? It's self-centeredness. All right, so there's self-centeredness, there's selfishness, there's denial. The last thing then is there is sorrow and suffering. You know that sin is the ultimate cause of all of man's woes and sorrows and struggles. And you know that. Those of you, some of you, you've been saved over the last couple years, some in the last 6 months. And you know that. You can look back at your life. You can look back with friends you know, relatives you know, and you see that sin just wreaks havoc. And it wreaks, it's suffering and it's sorrow and there's struggle. And that's, we want to say it's all kinds of other things. And in our society, especially in America, we come up with all kinds of ridiculous things. I mean, now it's not alcoholism, it's some disease. And it's not this, it's some disease. And it's not this, it's, you know, and you need more self-help. You need more self-esteem. And you know what happens with the self-help and the self-esteem? Well, yeah, because guess what happens when I just turn to myself? What do I know about myself? All have sinned. So when I just rely on myself, I get more depressed. And that's what happens. So in our society, you have people that are turning to themselves and they've been told, you got to turn to yourself and you need more self-esteem. Well, within myself, I just depress myself even more. And so it's more depression and more depression and more depression because the answer is not self. Because myself, I'm a sinner. And what is that? Sorrow and struggle and suffering. That's what happens. Okay, that's all the result of sin. Okay, so the third thing then, the fall resulted in an act of willful disobedience. The fall brought immediate changes to Adam and Eve. And number three, the fall brought sin and death upon all mankind. All right, so where do we find that? There's a verse. The fall brought sin and death upon all mankind. And if you can write a verse down, Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. It's a very important passage for you to know. Romans chapter 5. Romans chapter 5. And then I'll read it. Romans chapter 5. Look at Romans 5 and starting in verse 12. All right, the whole chapter would be good for you in learning these concepts of sin. But Romans 5, look at verse 12. Wherefore, as by one man, and guess what it says? Sin entered into the world, and guess what else? And death by sin. And so death passed upon all men. Here's that phrase again, for that all have sinned. Okay, so this whole passage tells us that death is passed upon us. Why? Because Adam sinned. Right? And it's now upon us. And then later in the passage, though, it tells us, for if by one man's offense death reigned, by one, much more they which receive abundance of grace and the gift of righteousness shall reign in life by one, Jesus Christ. Therefore, as by the offense of one judgment came upon all men, to condemnation, even so by the righteousness of one, the free gift came upon all men unto justification of life. I know that's big words, but this is what, boiling it down, one man brought sin upon us. One man, the man Christ Jesus, when he died, brought justification or eternal life to us. So one man, Adam, he brought that curse, the curse of sin. Jesus, being the perfect man, he was a God. He was God, not a God. He was the God. He was God, and he was man. You know, I can't explain it all to you. But I do by faith I accept that God and Christ became, they were one. Christ set aside his glory. The Bible says that in Philippians 2. And he became a man and he died for you and I. And so that one man, Jesus Christ, paid it all. We sing that, Jesus paid it all. Okay, so biblical explanation of sin. Then on the last part, all right, so that last page, we just have a couple minutes. As a direct result of the fall of man, then number one, every human being is a sinner. Every human being is a sinner. And I have three things under there. All right, Psalm 51. Every human being is a sinner by birth. By birth. In Psalm 51, it says, behold, I was shapen in iniquity, and in sin did my mother conceive me. All right, that's Psalm 51. All right, secondly, every human being is a sinner by birth. Secondly, by nature. Jeremiah 17:9, the heart is deceitful above all things and desperately wicked. The heart is deceitful. It's the nature of man to be deceitful. So by birth, by nature. Third, by choice. And this is the condemnation, that light came into the world and men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are evil. You might say this, you say, man, this is so good. Some of you, you've talked to me, man, this is so good. I got saved. I'm so excited. Why isn't everybody getting saved? Because men love darkness rather than light because their deeds are good. No, our deeds are evil. That's why the Bible says broad is the way. That means wide is the way that leads to destruction. But narrow is the way that leads to eternal life. Narrow. You see, the average man, the average woman, guess what we want? We want to do our own thing. We love our sin. Don't tell me that sin's bad. I like it. But they don't understand that sin, where's it going to take them? They die in that sin. They're going to hell. All right, the devil doesn't want him to think about that. He wants to tell him, oh man, this life, it's so great. No, no, no. You die in those sins, you're going to hell. So it's by birth, it's by nature, it's by choice, and it's by deeds. By deeds, Romans chapter 1. Who knowing the judgment of God, that they which commit such things are worthy of death, not only do the same, but have pleasure in them that do them. And we put a quote at the bottom. Men aren't sinners because they sin. They sin, that's a play on word, all right? They sin because they are sinners. What is it? It's our nature, isn't it? Man sins because he's a sinner. And that's what we have to understand. So that's why we're going through all this. One of our first things that we have to deal with. Last week, we're kind of introducing it. We got to pray. We got to prepare. We've got to go. We've got to talk. What do we got to talk about? I need to understand myself when I'm sharing with somebody what sin is. I've got to understand what sin is. As God deals with me about sin, then I can help this person that is unsaved realize that sin, man, they were born that way. But Christ came and took care of it. It is very important that they understand that their sin, that they are a sinner, and that their sin, left not taken care of, will take them to hell. That's that condemnation. And it's very important that they understand they got to turn from that sin. Okay? It's not saying that immediately, all right, some of you, you've been saved and you're trying to fight. I have a lady in the church, man, she's been a part of our church for years and years and years. And just at the beginning, I think it was in January, she was so excited. She came up to me. And God gave her victory over smoking. It was a fight for her. You know why? Because for years and years and years and years, she was smoking. But she wanted to have victory over that. And it wasn't just instantly. She got saved. She'd been trying to. But, you know, some things with our body, man, there is side effects. All right, nicotine is a real thing. All right, our body craves that. And she was saying, man, I just so hard. And she would do pretty good, and then she'd have a relapse. But she's so excited because God gave her complete victory. And see, that is the one difference that we do have, though. When I'm saved, I do have God. I have Christ. I have the Holy Spirit. And he can empower me to have victory. He wants us to have victory. All right. So in some sense, that person, once they understand that sin, guess what? They have somebody to help them conquer those sins. So our last point, as a direct result of the fall of man, every human being is a sinner. And then secondly, all sin is offensive to God. And I gave you a whole bunch of verses there that you can look at. It's very important when we're dealing with folks that they understand then what? Sin.